1957, the late Dr. Carl Gustav Jung was kind enough to allow us to complete 4 one-hour filmed interviews with him in Zurich. In the subsequent years, these 4 one-hour films in the unedited form have been shown to a good number of American psychology students. We noted that there were particular high spots in these films that seemed to be of greatest interest to them. So we decided to look back at some of these high spots and share them with you. So now let's go back to the very beginning of our first interview with Dr. Jung.
Now, Dr. Jung, many of us who have read a great deal of your work, of course, are aware of the fact that in your early work, you were, to some degree, at least in association with Dr. Sigmund Freud. And I know it would be of great interest to many of us to hear a little bit about how you happened to hear of Dr. Freud and how you happened to become involved with some of his work and ideas.
Well, as a matter of fact, it was in the year 1900, in December, soon after Freud's book about dream interpretation had come out, that I was asked by my chief, Professor Bleuler, to give a review of the book. I studied the book very attentively, and I didn't understand many things in it. It weren't clear at all to me. But from others' parts, I got the impression that this man really knew what he was talking about. A masterpiece, full of future. I had no idea then of ideas of my own. I was just it was just when I began to my career as an assistant. Yeah. In the psychiatric clinic. And then I began with experimental psychology or psychopathology. I applied the experimental association method by Wundt, and the same that has been applied in the Kraepelin's psychiatric clinic in Munich. I had studied the results, and I had the idea one should go once more over it. So I made these association tests, and I found out that the important thing in them has been missed, because it is not interesting to see that there is a reaction, a certain reaction to a stimulus word. That is more or less uninteresting. But the interesting thing is why people could not react to certain stimulus yeah. words or in an entirely inadequate way. And then I began to study these places in the experiment where the attention or the capability, apparently, of the test person began to waver or to disappear. And I found soon out that it is a matter of intimate personal affairs people were thinking of, or which were in them, even if they momentarily did not think of them, when they were unconscious, with other words, that nevertheless an inhibition came from the unconscious and hindered the expression in speech. And then I, in examining all these cases, as carefully as possible, I saw that it was a matter of what Freud called repressions. I also saw what he meant by symbolization.
In other words, from your word association studies, some of the things in the interpretation of dreams began to fall into place.
Quite
your own thinking.
Right. And then I wrote a book about the psychology of dementia praecox, it was
yes.
called then. Now it's schizophrenia.
Yes.
And I sent the book to Freud and wrote to him about my association experiments and how they confirmed his theory thus far.
Of course, one of the major areas of disagreement between Freud and Jung was Jung's belief that Freud placed too much emphasis on the sex drive. Now let's see how Jung reacts to some of my questions concerning this disagreement.
In the beginning, I had naturally certain prejudices against his conceptions. And after a while, I overcame them. I could do that from owing to my biological training, and I could not deny the importance of the sexual instinct, you know.
Yes.
But later on, I saw that it was very one-sided. Because, you see, man is not only governed by the sex instinct, there are other instincts as well. For instance, in biology, you see, the nutritional instinct is just as important as the sex instinct. Also, in primitive societies, sexuality plays a role much smaller than food.
Another very interesting observation that has been made is that the reason that Freud seemed to be so preoccupied with the sex drive is that that is, after all, what was preoccupying his patients. After all, they were living in a period of a very repressed mid-Victorian Viennese society. And as Freud began to work with the unconscious material, the sex drive would be foremost in terms of frustration and repression. Well, let's see how Dr. Jung felt about this possibility.
Well, it is certainly so that in the end of the Victorian age, there was a reaction going over the whole world against the taboos, the sex taboos, as one called them. One didn't understand anymore properly why or why not. And Freud belongs into that time, a sort of liberation of the mind of such taboos.
So it's a reaction then against the sort of tight, inhibited culture he was living in.
Oh, yes. And you see, Freud in that way, on that side, really belonged to the category of a Nietzschean mind. Nietzsche had liberated Europe from a great deal of such prejudices, but on concerning the power drive and our illusions as to the motivations of our morality.
Yes.
It was a time critical of morality.
Knowing of Jung's interest in the power drive, an obvious question at this point was to ask Jung to relate his views of the power drive as they relate to the sex drive. So now let's see how Dr. Jung reacts to this question.
It is a sort of finesse, almost, when you find out that somebody has a power drive, you know, and where sex only serves the purpose of power. For instance, a charming man, you know, all women think he is the real hero of all hearts. He is a power devil. Like a Don Juan, you know. The woman is not his problem. His problem is how to dominate. You see? And so, you see, in the second place, after sex, comes the power drive. And even that is not the end.
One of Dr. Jung's major contributions was his brilliant examination of the unconscious. So at this point, we asked him to discuss what to him was the meaning of the unconscious and the source of the unconscious. Now let's see how he reacted to this question.
The unconscious is something which is really unconscious. So you have no object, you see nothing.
No.
You only can make inferences, you know. And so we have to create a model of this possible structure of the unconscious because we can't see it. Now, you see, he came to the concept of the unconscious chiefly on the basis of the same experience I had made in the association experiment, namely that people reacted, they said things, they did things without knowing that they did it or said it. And this is something you can observe experimentally in the association experiment, where people cannot remember afterwards what they did or what they said in the moment where a stimulus word hits the complex.
One of the major constructs in Dr. Freud's theory of personality development was the Oedipus complex. It seemed, therefore, kind of interesting to see how Dr. Jung would define Oedipus complex. Also, we thought we might like to get him to relate the Oedipus complex to his notion of the archetype. Let's see, then, how Dr. Jung reacted to our questions relating to this point.
That is just what I call an archetype. That is the first archetype Freud has discovered. The first and the only one. He thinks that this is the archetype. Of course, there are many such archetypes. You look at Greek mythology and you find any amount of them, or look at dreams and you find any amount of them. But incest was so impressive to him that he even has chosen the term Oedipus complex, because that was one of the outstanding examples of an incest complex. And it is only the masculine form, mind you, because women have an incest complex too, but there it is not an Oedipus. So but it is something else. And so it is only the term for archetypal way of behavior in case of a man, a man's relation, say, to his mother. It also means to the daughter, because whatever he was to the mother, he will be it to the daughter, too. It can be this way or that way.
To many American psychology students, the notion of the archetype is perhaps the most controversial and difficult to understand among Jung's many contributions. So we thought we would ask Dr. Jung to define even more specifically what he meant by this notion of the archetype.
You know what a behavior pattern is?
Yes.
Now, the way in which, say, a weaver bird builds its nest, that is an inherited form in him. He will apply all certain symbiotic phenomena between insects and plants. They are inherited patterns of behavior. And so man has, of course, an inherited scheme of functioning.
And another point in our interview, I thought it would be rather interesting to see how Dr. Jung would illustrate the operation of an archetype in everyday life. Let's see how he reacts to this question.
Now, see, the archetype is a force, it has an autonomy. It can suddenly seize you. It is like a seizure. So, for instance, falling in love at first sight, that is such a case. You see, you have a certain image in yourself without knowing it of the woman, of the woman. Now you see that girl, or at least a good imitation of your type. And instantly you get a seizure and you're gone. And afterwards you may discover that it was a hell of a mistake. Or you see, a man is quite capable, he's intelligent enough to see that that woman of his choice, as one says, not no choice, he has been captured. You know, he sees that she's no good at all, that she's a hell of a business. And he tells me so, and he says, for God's sake, doctor, help me to get rid of that woman. He can't. He's like clay in her fingers. And that is the archetype.
Just to be a little bit more specific, Dr. Jung, you have used the concept anima and animas, and of course you're now identifying in terms of sex, a male and female.
Yeah.
Now, I wonder if you could elaborate, perhaps even more specifically, on these terms. For example, take the term anima, first of all. Now, this, is part of the inherited nature of the individual.
Well, you know, that is a bit complicated, you know. The anima is an archetype, an archetypal form expressing the fact that a man has a minority of feminine or female genes. And that is something that doesn't disappear in him, that is constantly present. And it works as a female in a man. Therefore, already in the 16th century, the humanists have discovered that man has an anima. Each man carries his female with himself, they say it.
So
that is not a modern invention. Now you see, the same is the case with the animus. That is a masculine image in a woman's mind, which is not sometimes quite conscious, sometimes it is not conscious, but it is called into life the moment that woman meets a man who says the right things.
I see.
And then because he said it, it's all true, and he is the fellow. No matter what he is. But those are particularly well-founded archetypes, those two. And there you can lay hands on the basis, as it were, of the archetype. They are exceedingly well-defined.
The concept persona was another one of Jung's interesting contributions. Let's see how Jung defines persona.
Well, this is a practical concept we need in elucidating people's relation. I noticed with my patients, particularly with people that are in public life, that they have a certain way of presenting themselves. For instance, take the doctor. He has a certain way. For instance, he has good bedside manners, and he behaves as one expects a doctor behaves. He may even identify himself with it and believe that he is what he appears to be. He must appear in a certain form, unless people don't believe that he's a doctor. And so when he's a professor, he's also supposed to behave in a certain way so that it is plausible that he is a professor, you know. So the persona is partially the result of the demands society has. And on the other side, it is a compromise with what one likes to be, or as one likes to appear, say. Take, for instance, a parson. He also has his particular manner, and as corresponding to the general expectation, and he behaves also in another way, combined with his persona, that is forced upon him by society in such a way that also his fiction of himself, his idea about himself, is more or less portrayed or represented. So the persona is a certain complicated system of behavior which is partially dictated by society and partially dictated by the expectations or the wishes one nurses oneself. Now, this is not the real personality, in spite of the fact that people will assure you that that is all quite real and quite honest, yet it is not.
Two widely used terms in psychology are self and ego. Dr. Jung has a very special way of distinguishing between these two terms. Let's see how he does it.
You see, when I say self, then you must not think of I, myself, because that is only your empirical self, and yeah, that is covered by the term ego.
Ego.
When it is matter of the self, then it is matter of a personality that is more complete than the ego, because the ego is only consists of what you are conscious of.
Your awareness.
Yeah. What you know to be yourself.
Yes. Of the many contributions of Dr. Jung, the ones that seem to have attracted the most attention are his concepts of introversion and extroversion. It seemed quite natural, therefore, that in the course of our interviews that we would discuss introversion, extroversion at great length. However, to begin this discussion, it seemed interesting to see how he would feel about the fact that many people interpret his notions of introversion, extroversion, as suggesting that the world is made up of only two types of people, introverts and extroverts. Let's see how he reacted to this question.
Well, Bismarck once said, God may protect me against my friends. With my enemies, I can deal myself alone. you know how people are. They catch a word, and then everything is schematized along that word. There is no such thing as a pure extrovert or a pure introvert.
Yeah. That
such a man would be in the lunatic asylum. Those are only terms to designate a certain penchant, a certain tendency. For instance, the tendency to be more influenced by environmental influences or more influenced by the subjective factor. That's all. And you see, there are people who are fairly well balanced and are just as much influenced from within as they are from without,
yeah.
Just as little. And so with all the finer classifications, you know,
yeah.
they are only sort of point de repère, points for orientation.
It seemed not only important to pursue Jung's notion of introversion, extroversion in more detail, but it seemed worthwhile to look at the special problem of the extrovert in the modern nuclear age. After all, the extrovert would be unusually tuned in to the realities and the threats of nuclear war. Let's see how Dr. Jung reacted to this.
The man who is going by the external world, by the influences of the external world, say society or perceptions, sense perceptions, thinks that he is more valid, you know, because this is valid, this is real. And the man who goes by the subjective factor is not valid because subjective factor is nothing.
Yeah.
No, that man is just as well based because he is bases himself upon the world from within. And so he is quite right, even if he says, oh, there is nothing but my fantasy, you know. And of course that is the introvert. And as the introvert is always afraid of the external world, he will tell you, when you ask him, he will be apologetic about it. He will say, of course, yes, I know, only my fantasies. And he has always resentment. And as the world in general, particularly America, is extroverted like hell, the introvert has no place.
Yeah.
Because he doesn't know that he beholds the world from within. And that gives him dignity, and that gives him certainty, because it is, nowadays particularly, the world hangs on a thin thread. And that is the psyche of man. Assume that certain fellows in Moscow lose their nerve or their common sense for a bit. And the whole world is in fire and flames. It is nowadays we are not threatened by elementary catastrophes.
Dr. Jung, we know of your concepts of thinking, feeling, sensation, and intuition. And of course, it would be very interesting to hear some expansion of the meaning of these particular terms as related to the introvert-extrovert dichotomy.
Well, there is quite a simple explanation of these terms, and it shows at the same time how I arrived at such a typology. Namely, sensation tells you that there is something. Thinking, roughly speaking, tells you what it is. Feeling tells you whether it is agreeable or not, mm-hmm. to be accepted or not, accepted or rejected. And intuition, now there is a difficulty. You don't know ordinarily how intuition works. So when a man has a hunch, you can't tell exactly how he got at that hunch. or where that hunch comes from. It is something funny about intuition. I will tell you a little story. I had two patients. The man was a sensation type, and the woman was an intuitive type. Of course, they felt attraction. And so they took a little boat and went out to the lake of Zurich. And there were those birds that dive after fish, you know.
Yeah.
And then after a certain time, they come up again, and you can't tell where they come up. And so they began to pit. Who was the first to see the bird? Now, you would think that the one who observes reality very carefully, the sensation type, would of course win out. Not at all. The woman won the bet completely. She was beating him on all points. Because by intuition she knew it before.
I see.
Now, how is that possible?
Yeah.
Well, sometimes, you know, you can really find out how it works by finding the intermediate links. You see, it is a perception by intermediate links, and you only get the result of that whole chain of associations.
Yeah.
Sometimes you succeed in finding out, but more often you don't. So my definition is, intuition is a perception by ways or means of the unconscious.
Dr. Jung developed 8 different personality types. He did this by combining his notion of the 4 functions, thinking, feeling, sensation, and intuition, and combining them with the notions of introversion, extroversion. Of all of these specific types, perhaps the most subtle and most difficult to understand was his intuitive introvert type. So it seemed quite in order to help us to understand more specifically what he meant by intuitive introvert type, to ask him to distinguish between the intuitive introvert and intuitive extrovert types. Let's see how he reacted.
Well, you know, you have chosen a somewhat difficult case, you know, because the one of the most difficult types is the intuitive introvert.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
The intuitive extrovert you find among hunters, bankers, gamblers. That is quite understandable.
Yeah.
But the introvert is the introverted variety is more difficult because he has intuitions as to the subjective factor, namely the inner world. And of course that is now very difficult to understand because what he sees are most uncommon things, and he doesn't like to talk of them if he's not a fool, because he would spoil his own game by telling what he sees, because people won't understand it. For instance, once I had a patient, a young woman, about 27 or 8, and her first words were, when I had seated her, said, "You know, doctor, I come to you because I have a snake in my abdomen." I said, "What?" "Yes, a snake, a black snake, coiled up right in the bottom of my abdomen." And I must have made a rather bewildered face at her. And she said, "You know, I don't mean it literally, but I should say it was a snake. It was a snake." Now, you see, our further conversation a little later was that she said, that was about in the middle of our treatment, that only lasted for 10 consultations. She had foretold me, "I come 10 times, and then it's all right." I said, "How do you know?" "Oh, I got a hunch," she said. And really, about the 5th or 6th hour, she said, Doctor, I must tell you, the snake has risen. It is now about here. Hunch. And then, on the 10th day, I say, now, this is our last hour. And do you feel cured? And she said, beaming. She said, you know, this morning, it came up and came out of my mouth, and the head was golden. Mm. And those were her last words. Now, you see, that same girl, when it comes to reality, she came to me because she couldn't hear the step of her feet anymore, because she walked on air, literally. She couldn't hear it, that frightened her. And then she came to me, asked her for her address. And then she said, oh, pension so-and-so. Well, it is not just called pension, but it is a sort of pension. And it is, I never had heard of it. And I never have heard of that place. Well, it's a very nice place, he said. Curious enough, there are only young girls there, very nice and very lively young girls. And they have a merry time. I often wish they would invite me to their merry evenings. And I said, but they amuse themselves all alone. Said, oh no, there are plenty of young gentlemen coming in. And they have a beautiful time, but they never invite me. It turned out that it was a private brother.
Yes.
Toward the end of our interview sessions, we thought it would be interesting to ask Dr. Jung to respond to questions concerning the contemporary scene. One such question related to his feelings about the excessive use of drugs in the United States and what he felt to be the cause of this excessive use of drugs. Let's see how he reacted.
American life is in such a way so one-sided.
Yes.
And so deraciné, uprooted, that you must have something to compensate the earth. You see, you have to pacify your unconscious all along the line because it is in absolute uproar.
Yes.
So at the slightest provocation, you have a big moral rebellion in America. Look at the rebellion of modern youth in America,
yes.
The sexual rebellion and all that, because
yes.
the real natural man is just in open rebellion against the utterly inhuman form of life. They are absolutely divorced, you know, from nature, in a way, and that accounts for these. That drug abuse.
One of Dr. Jung's most provocative contributions is his analysis of alchemy and his attempts to relate alchemy to individual development and the unconscious. On the last day of our interview, we asked him to discuss his alchemistic philosophy and the way it relates to the unconscious. Let's look, finally, at these few comments of his on this point.
In our days, we have such and such a view of the world, such a philosophy. But in the unconscious, we have a different one. And that we can see through the example of the alchemistic philosophy that behaves towards the medieval consciousness exactly like the unconscious behaves to ourselves. And we can construct or even predict our the unconscious of our days when we know what it has been yesterday. Now that is, with a few words, the development of my ideas.
In 1961, Carl Jung passed away. We hope these films will contribute to a continuing interest in his work.